that we may eat meat that is convenient unto us, meat that will change our life. Lord, feed us by your Spirit. Let no word come from men. Let every word that proceed from this pulpit, O God, be inspired and directed to our knees in Jesus' name. We glorify you because you are the one that speaks when no man can speak. You are the one, O God, that could make anyone to remain quiet when you want them to be quiet. Let this be a moment, O God, when you speak forth, and let no power resist your word. To you be praise forever. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, by the grace of God, I want to share something the Lord dropped in my spirit in the middle of the week with you. I'm going to take you in a journey into the book of 1 Kings chapter 17. Some of you may be familiar with the passage, but quite an interesting one, because I can see God has something for you there. You're moving from one level of glory to another, from one level of grace to a higher grace. And I say today that the Lord's word come to you not in its weakness, but in its strength and in its power, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 1 Kings chapter 17. I'm beginning to read from this one. And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, but according to my word, and the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, get thee hence, and turn thee eastward, and hide thyself by the brook Kerit, that is before Jordan. And it shall be, that thou shalt drink of the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to come to feed thee there. So he went and did according to the word of the Lord. For he went and dwelt by the brook Kerit, that is before Jordan. And the ravens brought in bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening. And he drank of the brook. And it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up, because there had been no rain in the land. Let me stop here for a moment and pin your eyes to verse 7. And it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up. The reason, obvious, there had been no rain in the land. And the brook dried up. So my subject today is when the brook dried. What next? When the brook dried, what next? And for Elijah, the brook dried up. Now let me take you back from the beginning of the chapter. Elijah was a man of God, called by God to be a prophet. And he was in the land of Gilead at the time when Ahab was insulting God through his idolatrous practices. And God looked for Elijah's message. And the message was that there will be no rain for 3.5 years in the land. And this is going to have a serious consequence, not just on the people or on Ahab and his people. It's going to have consequence on all the people of the land. Whether they believe in God or they don't believe in God, everyone is going to have a taste of this judgment. So when God sends you an errand sometimes, God is mindful. He understands there are innocent people who will be affected, but God has a plan for every one of his children. In the midst of chaos, God has got an answer. The fact that God has spoken through Elijah does not exempt Elijah from the suffering and the pains. But God has a way out. If God has given you a mission, God has given you all it takes to accomplish that mission. If God has chosen you for a message, for a something, for something to be done, God has an answer to meet your need in that situation. It's not going to be easy, especially in this lifetime, in these last days, to do the will of God. But you gotta do the will of God regardless of how difficult it is. Whatever it may be, whatever people may have to say about you, you have to stay strong and be happy and be ready to discharge your responsibility with all faithfulness. And Elijah, hearkened unto the word of the Lord, and Elijah stepped out to fulfill the word of God. And he went straight before the king and declared that the word of the Lord has said unto him. He said, get thee hence, and told him, expected Elijah to deliver the message. And Elijah said unto the man, unto the king, said, as the Lord God of Israel lives. Now what he's saying is that this word is not coming from me. I am a messenger, and the message is greater than the messenger. So I'm going to declare to you what God has said to me, and you better be ready for the wrath of God. And Elijah said, as the Lord God Israel lives, before whom I stand, in other words, whom I represent. I'm not representing man, I'm representing God. And if I'm representing God, listen to what that God has to say, there shall not be dew. Hallelujah. Not a drop of water. Not to talk of rain. There shall not be dew nor rain in the land for 3 years. But according to my word. But don't forget, his word is not his word. His word is God's word. God spoke to him to deliver this word, and he had come and delivered the word. And God said, haven't spoken my word, haven't obeyed me, I'm going to hide you somewhere. A moment of trouble, God will hide you. A moment of difficulties, God will hide you. No matter how difficult the situation may be in our society today, God's eye is running to and fro over his own children to protect them, to give them his blessing, and to ensure they are safe. Hallelujah. I don't want you to worry about your safety. I want you to be concerned about doing the will of God, because God is always ready to shield and protect you. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
So Elijah, who sent him the message, can actually speak through him to cause Ahab to become paralyzed or for something terrible to happen to him. But God needs him to for something greater than that assignment. Every time God gives you an assignment to do, it is just one out of the many assignments. There are other assignments waiting for you. All God wants you to do is to obey the very first call. Once you obey God in the first call, there is another call waiting for you. Every step of obedience takes you higher in the realm of the spirit, in your relationship with God, to the point where God can utterly depend on you and will do nothing without you. He said to Abraham, can I do something without my friend Abraham knowing of it? No. So God depends on you, and as much as you obey and remain faithful to him, God will continue to use you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, Elijah has spoken, and the word of Elijah has to come to pass because he has spoken on behalf of God. Every prophet of God speaks on behalf of God. If they have not spoken on behalf of God, they have spoken on behalf of themselves. And their word will never stand. And their word will never prevail. I don't care whoever prophesied to your life. If they have not prophesied according to the word of God, it shall never come to pass. In the name of Jesus, because a prophet is God's spokesman. And if God has not spoken, no one has spoken. If God has not said it, no one has spoken. It's only the word that comes from his mouth that shall prevail. And God sent him to hide himself by the brook Kerit. I've taken time to look at separate. It means separation. And God sent him to this place so that he can be refreshed. And the Bible described saying that the place called Kerit is after Jordan. A brook is not a river. A brook is just a small stream that will dry up in the dry season. A brook depends on that on other inlet of waters. So it's not a standalone water, it's not a river, and it will dry up when there is dry season. But Jordan is a river that will run throughout the year, no matter how harsh the weather is. But God did not send Elijah to a comfortable zone. God sent him to a place where there is limited resources. So sometimes when God places you in a place of discomfort, it is not because God has no other place better than that to place you. God has placed you in that place for a reason, and he wants you to learn one or two lessons which will transform and change your life and make you become the kind of man that he wants you to be. Praise God, somebody. I always think that, why God, why did you let me come into this place? Why did you not leave me where things are good and better? But every time I think this way, I remember the word of God, and I remember the experiences of great men of God, that they never live in their comfort zone. And that is why they were fulfilled. They were achievers. That's why they were men who break through the ranks of darkness and the ranks of the enemy, and they obtained victory. They were men of faith. And if you're going to walk with God, you better listen now. Because God is not going to put you where you have abundance and forget about his name. No. And feed you. Elijah was there, encouraged by the bull carriage. And God was meeting his need. But as the name suggests, it's a place of separation. God took him out of the life of idolatry, and he brought him to a place to be separated unto him. Every time God wants to use you, there is always a call for separation, and there's no other way to do it rather than God to send you to a place where he felt that you can be thoroughly sanctified and purified and be set aside for his next mission. So God sent him into to Brook Carriage. And there God was going to test him. After you have done the will of God, don't think everything will go rosy. The fact that you are obeying God doesn't mean that you will not be tested. In fact, the moment you begin to obey God, get ready for tests. There will be numerous tests coming your way. If it is not from the enemy, if it's not from God trying to build your faith, it's going to come from the enemy trying to challenge your faith in God. Some people will say, well, I do everything, I am holy, I am righteous, I follow the word of God, I give my tithe, I give offering, I do everything that I'm required to do, but why has this thing befallen me? Why is it that I'm experiencing all this? I pray every day, I read my Bible every now and then, I even join the choir, I am even actively involved in the church activities. Why is it that things that not even happening to unbelievers are happening in my life? You are not like them. That's why you were separated unto God. He said, come ye from among them, come out from among them, and be ye separate, and I will receive you unto myself. You are not the same as those people. Don't compare yourself with others, because God's plan for you is not the same plan for that other person. Because you are uniquely made, and in the program of God, your God's plan for you is distinct, just as you are distinct from every other being. There is no other one like you. You are just you, and there is no one with the same mission as you. I tell you, and I used to say, that if there are 10 pastors in the church, all the 10 pastors have different anointing. They never share anything in common. The only thing they have in common is the title you give to them. You call them pastor. But as far as ministry is concerned, they have different ministry because they have different qualities from God. That's why Elijah is not Elisha. Hallelujah. And Elijah was there at the brook carry, and the ravens brought in bread and flesh in the morning and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. This is a miracle, because how can raven bring food to a man? Raven, as we know, is an animal who will eat whatsoever was given to him. But raven came and brought him food, and the raven never eat what was meant for him. The devil will never eat what God has for you. The devil will never steal what belongs to you. The devil has no reason, has no power to take what God has given unto you. Even though it's a raven, it's a consuming animal. That's to say that no one will take what belongs to you. No one will take what belongs to you. If the raven will not eat the meal of Elijah, no raven by whatever name in your life shall eat what belongs to you. And if at any time anyone has taken what belongs to you, I decree today that it will restore to you in tenfold in Jesus' name. Now we are getting there. And it came to pass after a while, soon after Elijah remained at Brook Henry, something happened. As it does in our lives, it came to pass after a while, your comfort is for a season, and your difficulties is also for a season. After a while that the brook dried up, the only source of living for Elijah, his only source of food and drink, finished. The brook dried up. So where will Elijah get water to drink? And he had made a decree, there will be no rain for 3 years. Until the end of 3 years, there will be no water anywhere for him. Now, as some of us would do, when we come to a point like this, when the brook of our life gets dried, when our job, when we are told our job is over, is finished, we come to the end of this relationship. Or when the business comes to an end abruptly, or when something unusual happened in your life and your brook dried up, your source of livelihood is taken from you. Perhaps a child taken from you, a husband taken from you, a wife taken from you. What do you do when the brook dry? Elijah could think, as some of us would think, so well, since the brook carried dried up, I gotta find myself another place. I have to relocate myself from here to somewhere else. And then you want to begin to move from one place to the other, not minding the plan of God. And this is how some of us have wandered about and wandering aimlessly, purposelessly, because we have not listened and waited upon God to hear God's instruction for the next thing in our life. But thank be unto God, Elijah remained there. But there had been no rain in the land. So how is he going to cope when the brook dried up? I will lift up my hands to the hills. From where cometh my help? My help come from above. It's such a moment when you have to raise your eyes up and look up to heaven. Not a time to begin to look down and begin to wallow in self-pity. Not a time to begin to blame other people for your problem. Not a time to begin to think what other people did to you or somebody standing somewhere putting a curse upon you. It is a time for fellowship with God. It is a time for you to interact with God who has called you and assigned you to something. And the brook dried up. It's time for me now to go to that Jordan. I'm sure Jordan will not dry. Let me go and drink from Jordan. But God did not ask him to go to Jordan. And Elijah will not go to Jordan. Elijah waited upon the Lord. Come on, people, we gotta learn to wait upon him. And the word of Lord came to him. Whenever there is confusion in your life, don't go to men to ask for answer. Whenever there is trouble in your life, men are not the first point of call. God is your first point of call. And you gotta learn to wait to hear from him. Because God will speak at every situation. God will speak in every circumstance. God is always willing and ready to speak unto his children. And the word of the Lord came unto him. The word of the Lord will come unto you. God will speak to you. In that moment of despair, in that moment of anxiety, in that moment of worries, in that moment of confusion, you don't really know what to do. You are so worried. You are so concerned. God will always speak a word. And I want you to learn to listen to him. And God spoke to Elijah. And God said to him, it is not over yet. Look at yourself. It's not over yet. No matter where you are, it's not over yet. No matter what is happening, it's not over yet. It doesn't matter if the brook dry, it's not yet over, because the drying of the brook is the message unto me that it is time to move. But I'm gonna wait for him to tell me where to move to, because in the first place I did not bring myself up to this point. He brought me this far. If you believe God brought you this far, wave your hands unto him. He will lead me. I know the thought that I think towards you. I'm not thinking evil about you. I'm thinking good things about you. My thought is to bring you to a place of satisfaction. My thought towards you is to bring you to a place of blessing. I'm not cursing you, but I'm blessing you. Therefore, there is no reason to worry. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And God gave him the next instruction. God said to him, arise, get thee to Sarephath. When God takes you to Kerit, the next place is taking you to is Sarephath. Every point God moves Elijah, it was always for a reason. And every time God moves you from one place to the other, it's always for a reason. Perhaps you don't understand the reason for your move. You don't understand. Some of you, wait a minute. Some of you think you're being in England is just by accident. No, there are thousands of people who want to be where you are right now. Some of them have spent fortune, borrowed money, take loans, and yet they never get the visa. Some of them are even rich enough to be given a visa, but they have been denied. But you are here. You think it's by your power? You think it's by your effort? You think it's because you got the money to process the visa? No, 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 no. There is a reason why God has brought you over here. And don't make a mistake to mess the purpose of God, to mess the plan of God for your life while you are in this place. Your reason, number one reason, is that some people might know the God whom you have known. And second reason, perhaps it's because God has chased you wherever you are coming from Nigeria, from Cameroon. Attention, because your trouble then was that I don't have money, I don't have enough for my children, but if I'm able to go over there, things will be all right for me. And then you came here and you forgot that God allowed you to come here because he wants to use you. May you remember that God has purposed to use you for the end time, and you will now give the glory to the enemy. And God took Elijah to Sarephath. And what's the meaning of Sarephath? Sarephath means a place of smelting. You know where irons are smelted? Where you prune is a place to prune. Is a place to take out of you what is not meant to be in you. Everyone loves the gold. We love silver. We love all these ornaments, precious stones. But they are never precious. When they were taken from the earth, when they mined them, they were rough like mud. But after taking them through fire, after they were being smelted, then they come forth and begin to shine. This is exactly what is happening now. God has taken Elijah even to this point, so that he can take all the rubbish out of his life. And you need to come with God to such a place where all the rubbish in your life will be taken out, so that you can be more useful to God, so that you can be more satisfying unto God. And that's what God has done to him. And Elijah is going to face another challenge. Every hurdle you cross takes you to another hurdle. Imagine the athletes running in a relay race. You have to cross the hurdles to be a winner and cross it in good time to the finishing line. And Elijah has just begun a hurdle. He has just crossed one at Brook Kerit. Now he's moved on to Sarephath. And God said to him, behold, go thee to Sarephath, and which belong to Sidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. By what we see, we are not moved by what we hear. We are only moved by the word of God. To think of you being sent to a widow at such a dry season, what do you expect from a widow? But God sent him to the widow. God did not send him to the palace. God did not send him to one of the rich people. God asked him to go to Sarephath. One other thing about Sarephath I've not told you. That is where the wife of Ahab came from. Jezebel was from that region of Sidon. And Elijah has been asked to go to the home of his enemy. But if God be for you, who can be against you? If you be for God, who can be against you? Nobody. The life of a widow in Sarephath is connected to a prophet named Elijah. Sometimes your life is connected to someone's life, and without you, that person will never break through, because you carry the anointing that will give that person what they desire. Praise of God. But little do we know this. And I just say to people, it is not by chance you come across someone in life. Everyone you have come across in your life, there is a reason for it. You may not understand it. It may not be clear to your mind why you come in contact with that brother, with that sister, with that man outside, the moon sleeping on the street. There is always a reason for you to have an encounter with someone. I remember one time, blessed that she's not here this morning, I met a young lady at university, and we sat on the same table. And I was sitting down there looking at her. She just come to the uni. And I asked her, "What's your name?" And she told me. I literally forgot the name soon after I left the place. Then I asked her if I could give her my number. Then she said yes, reluctantly. Then she gave me her number, I gave her my number. And we both exchanged number. I don't know the reason why I did that, because I'm very reluctant in talking to younger people of that age, especially in such an environment. But somehow I did it, and I forgot about her. And then after a year, she rang me and said, "Hello, Tony, can I speak to you?" And I said, "Yes, I'm trying to remember who she was." Then she reminded my name and said, "Oh, I am so so and so." I said, "Oh, yes, we met at the cafe." She said, "Yes, yes, yes. Please, I need your help." And I said, "Really? Okay, that's all right." Then we arranged to meet at the cafe. Today, she's very close to my family. She's a member of this church. But that time, I never knew what I was doing. I didn't know there was a reason why God brought us together. But all I was thinking was I just met a young girl, and I don't know whatever. But today she's growing in the Lord, and she's rejoicing and giving glory to God that we have that contact. And I want to tell you that every time someone comes to your life, there is a reason. Don't throw them away. Even if there is a problem, remember, things don't just happen. There is always a reason for it. So Elijah was going to a widow of Sarephath. And Elijah would go to this woman. What for? Elijah had no more food. The raven no longer coming. The brook is dried. So now the next place is a widow's house. What is he going to get from a widow's house? Don't despise the days of small beginning. And don't despise the word of God. To obey is better than sacrifice. If God has sent you somewhere, even though it may not look attractive, even though it may not look promising, I want you to step out in faith as your father Abraham stepped out in faith when God called him out of the Ur of Chaldee and sent him to a land that he never knew about. And he walked with God by faith. And Elijah came. God said to him, "I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee." God said, "I have spoken to a woman." He began to ask himself, "God, what a drama is this again? The brook you sent me to dried up. Now you are sending me to an empty house, a widow. So he arose, the good thing and one great thing about this man, and that's why he's called a man of God. So he arose and went to Zarephath. He did not debate this before God. He followed God's instruction. He rose up and then he went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow woman was there. What a mighty God we serve. What a great God we serve. That he had made preparation for everything about you. Your worries and your anxiety had been taken care of long before you even think about it. Long before that problem even raised its ugly head. God had already made preparation for the answer for you. God had made widow waiting for Elijah right at the city gate. Elijah doesn't need to worry himself as to where is the address of this woman. Where does this woman live? The woman was already waiting. I tell you something. God had made a preparation for you. There is something waiting for you. After this message, believe the word of God. There is a miracle knocking at your door already. Because God has destined you to be favored and blessed. Hallelujah, somebody. And Elijah saw this widow woman. She was there carrying sticks. And he called to her and said, fetch me, I pray thee, a little water. This woman gathering sticks. Don't ask me, how did Elijah recognize the widow? Because Elijah is a prophet. The Spirit of God is in him. And if God has destined you to meet someone, amen. A lot of single people look around looking for men to find men. You don't find men. You don't find men. He that findeth a woman, a wife, findeth a good thing, obtaineth the favor of the Lord. But I tell you, what you are looking for is looking for you.
Amen.
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 What you are looking for is looking for you. Because you are not to find it, and he is not actually to find it, he is actually meant to get it. I'm not preaching on that today. We leave that until the 14th.
Amen.
Praise God. But what I'm saying is this, that Elijah recognized the widow by the Spirit of God. That's the widow. The woman carrying the stick is the widow. Go to the widow. And then ask the widow, can I have water to drink, please? And as she was going to fetch the water, the widow has got water. That's one of his needs. The woman has got water to offer Elijah. And Elijah said to her, she was going to get him water to drink. Elijah said to the woman, stop there. I don't think it's not ended yet. I'm not praying for just water. I am praying for everything. I'm not asking just for water. I'm asking for everything that makes life meaningful for me. So don't just give me water. I also need food. Because God is able to provide everything. In Philippians says, my God will supply your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Hallelujah, somebody. God's provision is eternal. And said, bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in thy hand. And she said, as the Lord thy God lives, I have not a cake. I'm not lying to you, man of God. This is the truth. I don't have a cake. But what I have is this. I have a handful meal in a barrel and a little oil in a cruse. And behold, I am gathering two sticks. that I may go in and dress it for me and my son, that we may eat and die. So the woman was preparing to die. The little she got is for them to eat it with no expectation of other meal. Their brook also has dried up. Elijah, who is God Almighty? But Elijah is the key to the breakthrough of the Sarepath widow. Without Elijah, the Sarepath widow and the son will eat and the last meal, and they will die because there is no hope for another. But God has sent you as the hope giver. God has sent you in the place of Elijah as the future giver. God has sent you as the late of provision. So, man of God, don't expect so much from me, the woman said. But Elijah said unto her, fear not, don't be afraid. Go and do as thou hast said, but make me thereof. Go and make the meal. As you said, you are going to make the meal for you and your son to eat and die. Go ahead and do it. Because I know it's not the end of your journey. That's not the last meal. Just do as you are told. The way to miracle is doing as you are told. The way to blessing is obeying the word of God without mixing anything with it. Don't help him. Don't help God. All you need to do is to put your hope and faith in this word. Do as you are told. Though the proof may dry, but God has a better offering. He has a better provision for you. But if God has met the need of Elijah alone, a carriage, how will he meet the need of a widow and Sarepath? God will stress you sometimes to be able to meet the need of somebody else. Go and do as thou hast said. But make me therefore a little cake first. Put me first, woman. I come first, woman. I'm not in the second place, woman. Whatever you are cooking, I'm the first to taste it, woman. Oh my goodness. What kind of a man is this? I'm thinking of food for my son. He's thinking of himself first. And he called himself a man of God. He's asking me to bring in an offering. What for? When I told him we have only a penny in our hands, and yet he's asking making demands on me unnecessarily. I'm not asking you to give an offering yet, but I'm talking about the sacrifice that precedes your blessing. There is no blessing without sacrifice. There is no love without giving. You cannot tell me you love God and you can give something up to God, up for God. No, you don't love him. You can give your time for him. You can give your resources for him, who is the beginning of your life, who is the ending of your life, who is the ultimate source of your resources. Elijah said, give me first. Give me first. And bring it to me. And after that, make for yourself and your son. That's being selfish, isn't it? Elijah was selfish. That authoritatively, as if he's the one who is working to for me. He's asking for my salary when he had never for once contributed to my hard work. But listen, if God has asked for it, just do it. And Elijah declared, one thing I want to leave with you today is that learn to declare the word of God in the face of adversity. Speak forth what it means to prophesy. Make a declaration. And Elijah said, for thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall cruse of oil fail, unto the day that the Lord send the rain upon the earth. What you think has ended has just begun. What you think is finished has just started. What you think is over is not yet over. That's what Elijah told that woman. He said, listen to me, woman. What you think is finished, it has just begun. Because this bush of oil will never fail. It will never dry. It will never remain empty. And I tell you, you will never lack or want again because of your obedience today. And she went and did according to the prophets. And she and he and her household did eat many days. Elijah eggs. You will always have leftover. You will always have your cup running over. Because it's the will of God. Because you never sacrifice anything for his name. And never have an abundance. Hallelujah. God does not borrow from you. If God borrowed from you, it's because he wants to enlarge you. If God asks anything from you, it's because he wants to use it as a point of connection between you and him for your destiny. And that is why you don't have to mourn. When God asks you for something, just jump on your feet. The Father he has asked you should give you a reason to believe that there is something great coming out of it. If God should ask you to give him money, don't hesitate, jump up on your feet, because you know that is coming back in multiple fold. Peter said, Jesus, Master, we have left everything to follow you. So what is going to be our own portion? Saying that we have left everything. And Jesus turned around and looked at him. And Jesus said, no man has left houses or father or mother who will not gain it in this world and in the world to come a multiple fold, a hundredfold. God is not a robber. He's not a magician. There is no abracadabra in him. If he asks you for anything, it's not for him to consume, it is for you to be blessed. And this woman who had only one barrel of oil failed, according to the word of the Lord, which is spoken by Elijah. So it was God speaking through Elijah. And today God is speaking through me to your situation. God is speaking to your destiny. God is speaking to your life. That whatsoever seems to be coming to an end, that is not meant to come to an end, shall be on the increase in the name of Jesus. Whatsoever has failed in your life, I decree in the name of Jesus to come back to life. Whatever is dead in your life, I command to resurrect. Break back to life in the name of Jesus. Wherever you have been denied of your right, I decree today, let the door be open again unto you. Let favor begin to follow you in the name of Jesus. And the brook dry. When the brook dry, what do you do? The brook dry for a reason. The relationship ended for a reason. The job ended for a reason. The business is over for a reason. The disappointment happened for a reason. Those who are backbiting you, they are doing it for a reason. God permitted them for a reason. Those who slander you, they are doing it for a reason. God permitted them for you to do it for a reason. Those who go behind destroy you, they are doing it, but God has a reason for allowing them. So when your book dried up, don't begin to cry. Don't time for you to expect something new to happen in your life. It's a time for God to take you out of that situation. so that you can hear his voice, so that he can take you to a place of abundance. Elijah would have died at the Brook Kerit. If God has not taken him in the first place, God has not taken him to Brook Kerit, Elijah would have died in the land, because Elijah is exposed to the enemy. But God hid him away so that he will not partake of the suffering. But Elijah need to see what God is doing. And God took him from Kerit to Sarephath so that the need of a woman would be met. You are the next prophet on errand. God is sending you into someone's life. Be sensitive to recognize when God is sending you out to meet somebody's need. Don't get there and see them and begin to look down on them and begin to ask them why can't the government provide for them? Why are they sleeping on the street? Why can't the government give them out of the benefits? It's not your question. It's not for you to query that. If God has asked you to go and feed the hungry, you just step out with the food and give them the food. If God has called you to provide them a shelter, you step out and provide them the shelter. Don't care about whether there is a government in place to make provision for them. If government has not done it, it's the reason why God has sent you out, for you to be their rescuer. And wait and see, God is not going to surprise you. The widow was surprised. May God surprise you this week. The remaining days in the morning, the year 2018, may your image to that end where you long for in this program, in the name of Jesus. Woo! I feel the power of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Just upon your feet if you don't mind.